Hi everyone, welcome to S4 Sharanya Science Classes. Today we are going to discuss about the second kingdom of five kingdom, that's actually kingdom Protista. And what is their classification, everything we are going to discuss, one by one we will discuss in this session. Before going to the topic, I would like to request you all, if anybody still remaining to subscribe my channel, please subscribe the channel. If you like the video, share with your friends and support me. So let's start kingdom Protista. So kingdom Protista, right? So we have learned about kingdom Monera, which is the only kingdom contain prokaryotes. Here the unicellular eukaryotes, right? So remaining all the other kingdoms, four kingdoms are all eukaryotes, and the eukaryotic, right, actually unicellular eukaryotes are included in kingdom Protista. So kingdom Protista mainly contain single celled, that means unicellular eukaryotes. Most of them, they are primarily aquatic, right? Very few are there, you can see that in the terrestrial, but mostly, right, 99% we can say that they are primarily aquatic in nature, right? And you can see that if they are motile, right, motile, that protista, then you can see that some of them having flagella, and even they are having cilia also, right? So that's actually the same structure, you can see that flagella and cilia present in protista also, right? If you are going for that mode of nutrition of protista, mostly protista can be undergone sexual reproduction, also asexual reproduction, like binary fission, transverse fission, every type of reproductive methods, that means sexually and asexually they are having, right? And the mode of nutrition, if you are going to detail in that, you can see that there are different types of mode of nutrition in protista. You can see that, that means some are actually photosynthetic, you can see that they will prepare their own food material. You can see that holotropic, they will engulf the food and digest, right? Saprophytic, they will depend on the dead and decaying matters, right? Even parasitic forms are also there, that means depending on the host, right? A mutual association, that means symbiote, that means mutual benefit. Both the host and the parasite, both are mutually getting benefits, then they are symbiotes. That type also you can see in protista, kingdom protista. Right, and in some organisms of this protista, even they are following mixotropic nutrition. That means both type of, there are different types of nutrition together, they will follow that. Such organisms, we will say that they are following mixotropic mode of nutrition. We'll learn about that. Already I have mentioned in previous, right, lectures, that's actually Euglena is one of the example. We will learn in detail later also, right? So here one thing you have to remember, that the photosynthetic floating protista are there. They are connectively known as the phytoplanktons. Photosynthetic, and they are floating protists. You can see that. I told that this is mostly aquatic, right? So they will be on the surface of the water. According to the water surface moves, along with that, these protista also move. So they are actually the floating protista, and they are actually utilizing the sunlight to produce their own energy. So that's why they are photosynthetic floating protists. And they connectively known as phytoplanktons, right? And there are free floating, right, holozoic protozoans are there, such as like animals, which is following that holozoic mode of nutrition. Like the same way, they are heterotrophic in nature, they are also free floating, but they are not producing their own food. They are actually engulfing that food particles and they are digesting. So that's why we are telling holozoic protozoans are there. Free floating holozoic protozoans, they are known as the zooplanktons. They are the zooplanktons, right? So here you can see that they are phytoplanktons are also there, zooplanktons are also there, right? Here phytoplanktons are photosynthetic and zooplanktons are holozoic mode of nutrition. That's the only thing you have to remember, right? One more thing you have to remember here. So kingdom Protista further classifies into chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, slime louts and protozoans. So here today we are going to discuss about chrysophytes first. So here we are going to discuss about chrysophytes. In the picture you can see that these are the chrysophytes, right? These groups actually mainly include diatoms and golden algae. Golden algae, otherwise known as desmites, right? So I told you already, you can see in the picture, these groups are actually, these are known as chrysophytes, and this includes mainly diatoms and golden algae. Yeah, mainly you can see that these are actually found in fresh water and also in marine environment also you can see that. That means these chrysophytes you can see in fresh water and also marine environments. and these can be mostly microscopic forms, and they will float passively in the water current. That means whenever the water will move freely on that water, it will be passively float. That means it's not moving along the water current. According to the water will move, along with that, these chrysophytes also move. So that's why they are known as planktons, right? So you can see that they are really microscopic. You cannot even see that with naked eyes, right? And they float passively. That means they are not at all utilizing any energy or anything. They're actually the water current, how they are moving. Along with that, these planktons also move. And here the main thing you have to remember here, the reserve food material in this chrysophytes, they're actually the oil, and there is a polysaccharide, right? So you can see that some other polysaccharides are there and an oil is there, right? So chrysolaminarin, that's actually the polysaccharide name, that's actually the reserve food material of this chrysophytes. So what is that? The reserve food material here is a oil and some polysaccharide. The polysaccharide name is that actually chrysolaminarin. And another thing you have to remember here, it's very important, right? In diatoms, right, there is a cell wall, right? Here in the picture I have shown that the cell wall, right, it's actually a two thin overlapping shells are there, one upper and other one the lower, like it's just like a soap box, right? If a soap box covering will be there, the same like that it is there. That's actually it fit together as in a soap box, right? An upper somewhat overlapping cover and lower a somewhat small cover, so it will be overlap each other. The shells will overlap each other, look like a soap box, right? And these walls, right, actually they are actually embedded with silica, right? And these cell wall are, because of that presence of silica, these cell wall are actually indestructible. That means it will not destroy that much easily, right? So these diatoms, when they left behind, large amount of cell wall deposits will be there in their habitat. That means after their death, you can see that there will be a large amount of the silica deposition. That means the cell wall, which is actually non-living substance. Once the organism is actually present inside the living part is actually inside that cell wall, you can see that. So once it will die, these cell wall will be as such, it will be embedded in the area where the habitat they are living. So because of that, the silica deposition will be there and it's actually indestructible in nature, right? So here you can see that diatoms, because of this silica amount, they will left behind large amount of cell wall deposits in their habitat. So because of this deposition, and there will be a huge accumulation means over billions of years, right? So there will be a huge accumulation of silica, and that area will be referred as diatomaceous earth. That's very common question, mostly asking question, what you mean by a diatomaceous earth? So diatomaceous earth is nothing but after the diatom dies, the cell wall will be left there in their habitat, and like the same will be so many millions of years, that will be cell wall. The silica cell wall will be accumulated in that area, and that will be forming a special plate, silica plate like structure, which is called diatomaceous earth. Because of that, grittiness, right? And their pore-like structure, these diatomaceous earth is very important. It has some economical values also there, right? So that's actually it can be utilized for polishing purpose, filtration of oils and syrups, the medical syrups and all, right? And these are actually, they have very highly smooth. So it can be utilized for polishing purpose also. Right. And one more thing you have to remember here, these diatoms, we already told that mostly they are that planktons, right? So they are the chief producers of the ocean, right? So here you can see that the main members are plankton. So they are the chief producers of ocean. Once again, I will conclude what you mean by that. So as I told, kingdom Protista, first member is chrysophytes, right? So chrysophytes mein mainly marine and freshwater forms hai, wo microscopic forms hai. Isme mainly diatoms and golden algae otherwise known as desmites. These two members are mainly included, right? So these are actually the planktons. We can say that wo planktons hai, kyun? Wo water current ke hisab se. That means it is freely floating in the water current. Jab bhi water current move hoga, uske saath they will move, right? So that's why you can see that they will be freely floating. That means passively floating through the water current. That's microscopic forms, right? And that's why they are mostly members of plankton, right? It can be phytoplankton and it can be zooplankton, right? So that's why they are planktons in nature, right? And one more thing you have to remember here, The chrysophytes, mainly they are having their structure, if you are checking that, diatom, right? Mainly diatom, they have a soap box like structure. I have already shown you in that previous picture. You can see that soap box like structure it is there, right? It's one another like this, right? So inside the organ is the living part is there. The cell wall is actually making a soap box like structure. This is actually made up of सेल वॉल दैट ना हार्ड सिलिका राइट सिलिका मटीरियल से बना हुआ है इसलिए बहुत ग्रिटी इन नेचर दैट मीन्स वेरी हार्ड वो इनडिस्ट्रिक्टेबल है इट विल नॉट डिस्ट्रॉय दैट मच ईजली राइट सो वंस दैट डायटम्स विल डाई ये सिलिका डिपोजिशन उसके नीचे राइट वॉट इज द वाटर रिजर्वायर वेयरएवर इट इज वो उधर पाइल अप हो जाती है राइट एंड इट विल फॉर्म ए स्पेशल दैट ना वॉट इज ए दैट ना माउंटेन लाइक और हिल लाइक प्लेट लाइक स्ट्रक्चर राइट विच इज इनडिस्ट्रिक्टेबल इन नेचर Like that, it will form, and it can be what we say extend 100 meters in length. That much, that now what we say after millions of years, not in a 2-3 days or anything. After millions of years, you can see that there will be some special that now rock-like structures, which is known as diatomaceous earth. Or because of this that now cell wall, porous cell wall in the nature, it can be utilized for different purpose. जैसे कि हम polish करने गए, right? और oil और that now syrups जो हम medical field में वगैरह syrups, ये सब की filtration में you can use that polishing the surface, right? Like that, it's just like a pumice stone. We can say that the pumice stone we are using, उसकी जैसा लगती है, right? So these are the main important things of diatoms. I hope it is clear for you. Thank you.